I shake so many hands.
You don't know where your hand's been.
Well, you don't know where my hand's been is the point. And I, every time I give someone a pound, I'm doing them a favor.
You are not a child actor. I think people have this idea of you as a kid actor, but you really were in your 20s when you became a film person, a television person.
Well, I didn't really have... I don't really know what people think about me, and that's probably a good thing, or I don't know what ideas they have about me, but certainly I didn't start acting until I was 21. So I was a young man. Certainly had lived a life already, a life that didn't include any expectations of the dreams that I would one day achieve, some of the dreams. But no, I wasn't in this business at all. I was very far from it. I knew nothing of it and imagined it little. And when I did, it was seemed something that was... I always thought that people that were in made music or in bands or were actors or in that part of the world were kind of like royalty. I thought you had to be born into it or anointed. I didn't realize when I was young that you could actually work your way into it. So it was kind of a fantastical thing to me.
So when it was happening, was that pleasurable? Were you just exploring and going with it?
Or? Yeah, when it started happening, it's pleasurable. It's also painful. It's a masochistic choice. And I always say to people that if you think you want to be an artist, not even just a musician or an actor, but an artist in general, I think, a really creative person, you have to be compelled beyond a reasonable doubt. Because if you aren't, it's not worth the heartache. It's not worth the psychological warfare. And certainly there are harder jobs out there, but it is one that's unique in its demolition of one's own ego. Mm. And the uncertainty and imbalance. You know, as an actor, it's a funny thing. Every time you have a job, it's your last job, possibly. You're unemployed all the time. Your career can come and go. Just because you work really hard doesn't mean that it's gonna necessarily fall in your favor. You have to rely on quite a few other people to work really hard and deliver, you know?
And then fortune also.
Exactly. I mean,
you don't know whether the film is going to work just because even the best intentions.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to lean back a little if that's okay. You don't know if the film is going to work either. So there's a number of things. There's just a lot of instability and there's a lot of imbalance. But there are also some really high peaks and an incredible climb. A lot of reward, a lot to learn. You know, really fascinating thing to create stories and to tell stories and to make things and share things with people, to touch people's lives in a really deep and meaningful way. That's a gift, a very rare and weird, you know, modern thing to do, and to be. And to be applauded for that is a bizarre. Mm. Thing as well, because the process applauds you enough, you know, so then to get the other stuff is incredible.
So was that what it was like for you from the early days? I mean, did you start with it kind of seeing it that way and approaching it that way, or did it take a while for you to figure out that this was a serious thing and you were going to be invested in that way, on that level?
I started out a painter, an artist. I really had no aspirations to ever be an actor. I was a visual artist, and you know, I think I still approach things in that way. In creative problem solving, but when I was in art school, I started taking photography class, and then that led to a film class. I was also taking, you know, sculpture and pottery and two-dimensional, three-dimensional design, all kinds of things, but for some reason I latched on. I really loved photography, but I needed more, and then something about film seemed to encompass everything that I was looking for. you know, time and movement and the ability to work and control kind of greater parameters, or work within greater parameters and have more control. But, you know, I started studying more avant-garde video art and film, fine art film, and certainly not traditional Hollywood narrative, mm-hmm. although I loved that, and that was a real interest of mine. But my plan was I would drop out of art school and I'd get a job as an actor, and that would help me get a job as a director. So that came out through that way. So certainly not, you know, brought into this as a child, or, you know, thought, oh, wouldn't it be cool to be famous and make movies, you know, which can be a fun thing, I'm sure, for some. But it wasn't on my radar.
So is there a point where you decided directing was not going to be your thing? Was it?
No, it's become a really big part of my life. You know, I mean, I've been spending so much time behind the camera more and more over the past 10 years. You know, I've done a lot of work under a pseudonym, Bartholomew Cubbins, which is the worst kept secret in town now. But I started it years ago using it so I could kind of work anonymously. And that's been wonderful. I've learned a lot. And in the 6 years that I hadn't made a film recently, that's what I was doing, is spending a lot of time behind the camera. You know, I have a documentary, a feature-length documentary that just came out in December as well. It's on iTunes now. It's called Artifact. But I've been working steadily, and you know, I'll probably make a narrative film within the next year or two.
So what is your relationship with a director as an actor? Is it
painful? I mean, unless it's Fincher, Aronofsky, Jean-Marc was great. You know, I mean, for me, it makes the relationship with directors difficult unless they are great at what they do. And then I'm in awe. But certainly the minute you make a mistake and step on set and you're underwhelmed, it can be challenging, because of course you see solutions where other people see problems. So there can be friction there. Not that it ever turns into something. You know, I always get along great with my directors, whether they're, you know, winning or failing. You know, I've always been kind of director-centric and have a lot of respect for the director.
So when you have a great director, particularly, are you a tool that, do you make yourself a tool of the director, or is it, are you looking for an interactive relationship?
Well, when I'm working with a great director, I think great directors hire people they really trust. Part of being a great director is being a great manager, a great leader, a great producer, and working with people that you can delegate tasks to. I mean, the greatest directors know they hire the greatest actors, and the greatest actors bring them things which they can use. So the actors aren't necessarily tools, but partners and collaborators, and, you know, fishermen and fisherwomen, women, and, you know, they go out and bring things. They hunt and gather and bring things, I suppose. So I think the relationship for me has always been one of trust and, you know, you're on an adventure together. Mm-hmm. Certainly in the case of Dallas Buyers Club, it was, you know, I had a very deep understanding and commitment and connection to the character of Rayon, and, you know, the door's always open for the director to jump in and join that journey and that process. I think Jean-Marc was really respectful and, you know, excited about what I was bringing to the table, and, you know, there was a lot of there wasn't a lot of friction there at all. It was wonderful.
So how much time did you put into Rayon before you ever got to set or near set?
Well, I only had about 3.5 weeks to prepare. So it was very intensive, very fast, furious, and a great way to do this kind of role, because it was so immersive, it was so challenging. So it was a nice way to get inside her skin. Mm. And the shoot was like that too. It was great.
Was it improved by what was lacking in terms of time and
I think so. I mean, I enjoy making films like this. There's not a lot of waiting around. You know, that can be the death for an actor, you know, hurry up and wait. It's not the time it takes to do the takes. It's the time between the takes. It takes the time, right? And that's just the curse of a shoot. You know, especially these days when they make, you know, some of those really, really, really big films. There's a lot of preparation time for every setup, every shot. So that can be a challenge, and I guess you just have to adjust. But as far as character work and deep immersive character work like Rayon, I mean, this is the way to do it. Dallas Buyers Club, you know, fast shoot, really intense, 25 days, no lights, no rehearsal, go, 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 go.
So how did, what happened 3 weeks before that, or that you suddenly knew you were going to jump into this?
Well, I hadn't read a script in almost, I hadn't read a script in years. I hadn't made a movie in almost 6 years.
And you just said, stop sending them to me. I'm not doing that.
Yeah, kind of. I think after a few years, you know,
of they like, stop sending them.
They start to believe that you're, you know, serious, and you're not really looking to go to work. But fortunately, this came up and someone sent it to me, and you know, was persistent, and I read it and I fell in love. I thought it was a great opportunity. I also knew that it was time for me to make a film, because there was a chance I would never make a film again if I didn't make this one, because, you know, that's a long time to go by willingly. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, and I had a life that was very full and fulfilled, and, you know, I didn't feel lacking. But I knew I owed it to myself to take another look, and I'm glad I did.
So you really didn't miss acting, particularly at that point, it sounds like.
Well, there were parts of it. I mean, I love filmmaking. I love the process. I love actors, and it's a really inspiring thing. But, you know, I had other lovers. You know, it's not like I wasn't satisfied. You know, out of sight, out of mind, maybe that sort of thing. But I knew that, you know, it was time to come back, and I'm glad I did with this.
So does it wet your beak for more, or are you, is it a, does it get you excited about doing more acting?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, this certainly makes me, this and all the other great films out this year, it makes me want to make more film. You know, whether it's watching Redford and All Is Lost, you know, that's inspiring. It makes me want to be an actor. Wolf of Wall Street makes me want to be an actor. 12 Years a Slave makes me want to be an actor, and a director and a producer. You know, it inspires me to be a part of this world. You know, those are really wonderful films, and it's all the sweeter to be nominated alongside these people and their projects.
What's interesting, because those couple movies, you know, Leo is a producer on his movie.
Oh, Ed is he?
A producer on his movie.
Oh, great.
And, you know, they're both into production companies as well as acting. And it sounds like, it feels like this generation of actors, the boundaries don't seem to be as tightly held as they used to be.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, there have been great actor producers for decades. People that have had great success, and also actor directors, but I think a lot of boundaries and barriers have been taken down and broken. You know, even musician actors, mm-hmm. actors, musicians, that happens sometimes too, and I think that's just a sign of the times. You also see, you know, painters that making great films, whether it's Steve McQueen or Julian Schnabel, you know, and that's a good thing. I think that people can offer other things in different areas.
Do you have boundaries for yourself? I mean, do you think like that, or is it even an issue?
I don't really think in terms of boundaries, but what I think it's important to do is to say no to things like I've done in my life, so that you can excel in other areas, because sometimes you need to focus on your knitting. You need to really dive deep and stay decisive. And when I make a film, I shut everything else out, and I focus on that film. So you have to prioritize, because you don't want to do many things and do them not so well.
And is it the moment? I mean, Rayon, fairly short period of time in your life as a character.
Yeah.
The movie was over. There was a wait till the movie opened and everything, but
yeah,
opening things doesn't seem to be your priority either. I mean, obviously you're putting yourself out there for the film and all, but you know, doesn't sound like the commercial aspect of it is really your priority. Are you taking a sweet moment from that, and that's what you take away from a picture like this? I mean, besides,
you know, what I take away a lot of things is that, you know, you kind of get reminded of the possibilities of life, that you can, that wonderful things can happen when you work really, really hard. That's a great thing just to be reminded of again and again. And you know, I think my investment in this film obviously was a creative one, an emotional one. The fact that people are seeing the film too is really great. I've made a lot of films that no one's seen, that haven't been released. So when they hit their mark and they connect with people and they work in some way, it's a wonderful thing.
So you're not up on the mountain just kind of there for the art. You want to connect with people. You want, that's the critical, a critical part of it for you.
Well, I think, I mean, you can't deny that film is a public medium. It's a communicative experience. If it wasn't, you wouldn't record the data. You wouldn't make the play. You wouldn't write the book. You'd keep it in your mind. I mean, write it for yourself maybe and then read it later. I don't know. You can live in a closet. Mm-hmm. But I do think that communication is a part of the process, and that that still stays in the world of art. You know, you put a brush to the canvas and you start to say something. You tell a story, or you share a moment or a feeling, right? You put it on the wall and you share your idea, your perspective with other people. They in turn consume it. They have an opinion or a personal or private experience, sometimes in a very public place. Mm-hmm. And that becomes a part of the fabric of a culture or society, right? So I think that's very much a part of the creative process. People seeing, ingesting, digesting, consuming a work. Even this interview. Mm-hmm. If it's not seen, it's not completed, right? Creating, digging something up, dreaming up a conversation, sharing it with people, mm-hmm. that being consumed and in turn becoming a part of their lives. That's the osmosis of it all, I guess, right?
And completely different being on stage in front of people?
Yeah, being on stage is completely different in a simple way. You know, when you're on stage, when you're on stage, well, let me put it this way. When you're making a film, you're working with an outline, a story, a character, building that character, given circumstances, very collaborative process. You have your one vertical within this kind of greater scheme. When you make music, you are yourself when you're on stage. There's no character. Mm-hmm. Nobody else is giving you the lines. You wrote songs and stories usually from your gut or your heart. Sometimes people write conceptual things or rock operas or something. But most of the time, you're on stage, you're who you are. And sometimes more of yourself than you ever are. But you know, making music, if you happen to also be the songwriter and producer and, you know, direct your own videos and work on production for your shows, and you know, as musicians have to do these days, become, you know, social media experts and marketers and producers and half a record company and managers in a sense, then it's probably more akin to being a writer, director, producer who also edits your own films. Mm-hmm. It's a much more immersive thing. You're more responsible for different components. Doesn't mean one's more rewarding than the other or more challenging, but I would say that would be the difference.
And are you a social media person?
Yeah, you have to be. And as a musician, you absolutely, it's a necessity.
You like it?
There are parts of it that I like. I like communicating. I don't like some of the frivolous bullshit about the social media, but I certainly like the power that it gives people, artists. It was a day and age where I had to rely on you. Mm. I had to rely on Rolling Stone, or I had to rely on MTV, or I had to rely on CNN to get my story out. And those are all awesome sources of information. Mm-hmm. They help write, you know, they have really great writers that can filter information and share it with people. I've been the recipient of that hard work and, you know, that creative writing, and that's awesome. But it's also really great to give artists the ability to speak directly to their audience, because what it does is it changes the power balance with some of the bigger other third party intermediaries, right? Like the record companies, like the labels out there around the world. And when you're doing things like touring the world and, you know, going and playing concerts and putting out albums and music, and you live in a world where digital goods are incredibly important and pervasive, I think that social media is a great tool that's changed the leverage as far as the artist and the third party goes. So that's an awesome thing. It's still great for third parties, if they're creative, to get in the middle and provide solutions, whether it's media or labels or promoters or whatever it is, publishers. That's great if they provide a service that helps the artist, but it's nice to have a little bit of the balance change so you don't have to ask permission in order to get your message out to the public.
And what about the feedback part? Is that...
Well, the feedback part is interesting. I mean, you have to be good at filtering, you know, nonsense from information, from data. Mm-hmm. But data is great. You know, data is wonderful. If you think about it like a hospital, what would a hospital be without data? You know, an empty building filled with, you know, people in bandages, right? You need data. You need history. You need to know that person's allergic to penicillin. This person over here has a history of heart disease. And I think that, you know, in a way, whether you're in the film business or you're in the tech business, you can use data to learn and to take that information and do a better job for your audience, for your customers, for yourself. And I think that can be a good thing to know. I'm not saying that everyone should read their comments on any given social platform, but there is a lot to learn as far as feedback goes, whether you're an artist, a brand, a company, or a government.
So better is not just an internal thing for you. It's you actually are interested in the feedback of the world and on some level, not all of every word of it, but
yeah, I think that you can get some kind of a gist, you know. It's democratic, right? At the end of the day, it's a vote, and a comment is sometimes even more than a vote. It gives you some insight into the subtext of why people may be voting that way. So it's an interesting way to learn about people. You know, I've been involved with technology for a long time. It was a necessity at first for me, but I'm incredibly entrepreneurial. I've started 3 companies outside, which would probably surprise a lot of people. But I have a ticketing company, an e-commerce company, and a platform that's more kind of pure tech, where we're rethinking how we're able to share what we do live, and to give artists and event creators and audiences something really valuable and a chance to have a sustainable system as well.
So are those an artistic endeavor for you on some level?
I find a lot of art and creativity in some of the other side of the brain, you know. I mean, it is especially in tech and in business. I think people there's a lot of creativity going on there. And I also think it's important for creative people to participate in that, in the digital architecture that's going on right now. I mean, there's a world being created right now, and I think that artists should have a seat at that table. You know, not just businessmen or technologists.
Well, they certainly fight to keep the artists from having too much of a seat. I mean, it's an ongoing battle, it feels like.
There's always a battle between art and commerce. It's that uneasy relationship. It's like two people that they fuck and it's amazing, but that they just can't even have a conversation.
Yeah.
Without getting into an argument.
It's getting harder. I mean, it's hard. The unions out here have gotten kind of the crap beat out of them the last 10 years or so.
Yeah.
Particularly as technology's evolved. It's kind of like studios have figured out how to take advantage of the fact that nobody's quite, you know, they're one step ahead of where the public is. So they kind of see it coming, and they've undercut, I think, the power of the artist to survive, really.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people doing a lot of really well, but a lot of the people in the middle class are kind of getting crushed. As artists. And
yeah, I mean, there's a fundamental shift happening right now. I mean, anything that can be live in a digital way will live in a digital way. That's the rule. You know, if you have a good that can be ones and zeros, it will be ones and zeros. Eventually, this camera, you know, it'd be the size of a chip and it has contact lens, you know, that's inevitable.
This is a third of the size of the camera we were using 6 months ago. So.
Yeah, and it won't be won't even be a camera or lens soon. It'll just map the space. Mm-hmm. You won't need this light at all. There won't be lights. That will be an archaic thing. I mean, lights will be looked at as laughable at some point because we're going to be able to map the space that we're in, mm-hmm. and you'll be able to choose any kind of camera, any kind of lens, any kind of flare, any kind of angle, any kind of steady cam or jib arm. Or handheld shot that you want, and I think that's probably sooner rather than later.
And it sounds like that would be of interest to you. I mean, like a movie, like a motion capture kind of thing.
You know, I've never done that sort of thing, and I keep telling myself that, you know, the next thing I do, I'm going to explore in that world because I think it can be incredibly imaginative. But it's also the sort of thing like, you know, sometimes I travel a lot, and you go into a hotel, and it's obviously been designed by a computer. Like everything fits in a certain place. They've used the space really well. You know, obviously there's some financial advantage to using the space well in a building, and then you can sell more rooms, have more rooms. But there's some humanity that's lost as well.
Well, actually, it was a fascinating thing because Peter Jackson, when they did Tintin, I guess, was saying how when he held the digital camera, which you can basically move your hand and it does, you know, pan up or does a fly up to the 20 feet in the air or whatever. That when he used it, it looked like him, and when Spielberg used it, it looked like him, and when Jim Cameron used it, it looked like his, you know, that immediately the artist was able to actually take that technology and make it somehow their own, which is fascinating.
Yeah, I think that's true. I mean, it's a similar thing as if you work with different DPs or, you know, editors. You know, I do that all the time, and at the end of the day, it still looks like Bartholomew Cubbins' piece, you know. It's easy to get your fingerprints on things. All this stuff, they're just tools. You never want to be a slave to technology, but you make a technology a slave to your creative ideas.
So are the passions that you came into all this with 20 years ago, is this just all an extension of the passions continuing, or?
I think in some ways it is, because, you know, I'm spending my life doing a lot of creative things. I've always been entrepreneurial, you know, ever since I was a kid. And yeah, I think it's an extension of all of it. And
So it just keeps getting more interesting?
In a way it does. It, you know, because you lose a little of the panic of youth, mm-hmm. you know. And I think you have, there's hopefully some grace comes and knowing that it's going to be okay. That's a nice thing. But sometimes the panic, the fear is what drives you ultimately to greatness. So it's a bit of a conundrum.
So do you ever have a hard time finding that passion, that driving thing?
No, I never do. I'm always kind of compelled beyond a reasonable doubt, like I said.
And a good thing.
Yeah.
See, my old Jared Leto story was that 15 years ago, I was sitting in Swingers, and there was this blonde guy with very short hair by the phone, and he was like staring at me, and I couldn't figure out why he was staring at me, and then I realized it was you. I think it was you, at least. And I saw Fight Club a year and a half later, and I think you were out there developing your character.
Oh, really? Angel
Does that sound
face.
Like you?
It sounds like me. I mean, my God, it must have been a long time if I was on a payphone.
Well, you were hanging out by the payphone. There was like the bathroom on either side. And
oh, really?
And it looked like you were trying to pick a fight, is what it felt like.
Oh, was it?
And I'm, yeah. And I was pretty younger and bigger at the time. And it seemed like you were doing your
thing. I probably was. I was out being provocative and just kind of looking into that face of uncertainty, or, you know, that fine line. And, you know, I remember I've done that quite a bit. But, you know, there is that weird space of that you can get into with other animals, you know, that unstable place. That's pretty interesting.
That's where the work is, I guess.
Yeah, the work's there. And, you know, every time you make a film, you have an opportunity to learn something. So you want to really push yourself to do that, or else you'll die. You'll be bored to tears.
It doesn't sound like you're bored very often.
I never get bored. The old cliche is true, only a boring person is bored, probably. But a bored person is certainly boring. Lots of things to do out there, you know?
Thank you very much.
Thanks, man. I appreciate the conversation.